Hi, kind Cavaliers. This is Mr. Holly again. Today is Monday, May 11th, 2020. Today we're going to focus on two different things for our video. We're going to focus on three-dimensional shapes and the parts that make up three-dimensional shapes. And we're also going to focus on plant parts for science. One thing I do want to say is I appreciated all the people who showed up for the Kind Cavs chat on Thursday. Hopefully the next time we'll get a few more. So thank you to Charlie and Liam for signing in. They heard a story. We told some jokes. We chatted for a little while. So remember, that's every Thursday, excuse me, at 1 o'clock, we will do a Kind Cavs chat. Basically, just like our snack time that we used to do right before we get ready to go to specials in the classroom. All right, so this week for three-dimensional shapes, what we're going to start talking about are the three main parts that make up three-dimensional shapes. And your job is to try to figure out how many of those parts each three-dimensional shape has. Let's start with the first part of a three-dimensional shape that is called a face. And when I say a face, when it comes to three-dimensional shapes, I'm not talking about this. A face on a three-dimensional shape is a flat side. So here I'm holding a cube. I have a face on top. That's a flat side. I have four going around that go straight up and down. And then I have the base on the bottom that is also a face, a flat side. So the face of a three-dimensional shape is a flat side, or some people call it a flat surface. So a face is a flat side or a flat surface. The next part of a three-dimensional shape is an edge. An edge is the line where two faces meet. An edge is the line where two faces meet. So again, I have this cube in my hand. And the way I'm holding it, you can actually see two faces. We have this face here and this face over here. This line that goes straight up and down, where the two faces come together in a corner, that is an edge. So there are quite a few edges on a cube, because you have the edge where this edge here, you have the one I pointed out, you have the one down here on the bottom, there's another one on this side, then there's another one back here, and then down, the one at the base, then there's another one that runs straight up and down. So there can be quite a few edges depending on the shape of the three-dimensional object, your solid figure. The last part of a three-dimensional shape, if you talk about it as one, it's called a vertex. The plural, or if there's more than one, they are called vertices. The vertex is the point where two edges meet. So again, an example. And for this one, I think I'll use the pyramid. Right here, I have a square pyramid. If you notice on this square pyramid, when I turn it like this, all of the edges that go straight up and down come together to make this point here at the top. That point is a vertex, but it's not the only vertex on the shape. Because if I turn the shape this way, we have the square base. And on the square base, I have these two edges coming together to make this point. So that's another vertex. These two edges come together to make a vertex here. These two edges come together to make a vertex here. And these two edges come together to make a vertex right here. So when you're thinking about your solid figures, and you're trying to remember the terms face, edge, vertex. Face is the flat side. Edge is the line in the corner where two faces come together. And a vertex is a point in the corner where two edges, two of the lines, come together. Now, I don't want to do your entire assignment for you, and I won't do that. You guys know I always model some examples, and then I leave you to do the actual thinking and the work, and then you can ask me for help. But I do want to just do a couple examples, just so that we can understand, so that I feel you will understand exactly what faces, edges, and vertices are. I'm going to start. This is my sphere. This is that decorative ball that I told you that my wife has in the house. It's the only example of a sphere I could find. My kit didn't have a sphere in it. So I'm looking at this sphere, this ball shape. And I'm going to start by thinking about a face. Well, I don't see any flat sides on a sphere. So the number of faces on a sphere would be zero. Well, if it doesn't have any faces, the definition of an edge was the line where two faces meet. So if it doesn't have any faces, I really don't see how it can have any edges either. Because if there are no faces, then there's nothing where the two edges come together to make a line. So a sphere also has zero edges. And if we look back at the definition of vertices, vertices are the points where two edges meet. Well, if there are no edges to meet, then there are no vertices either. There are no points in a corner on this sphere. So for a sphere, it's zero faces. Excuse me, zero edges and zero vertices. All zero. Now, let's move. I'll do one more with you, and I want you guys to try the rest at home. Remember, there are there are rectangular prisms, there are cones, there are cylinders, there are cubes. And there are also pyramids, and depending on the type of pyramid base you have, this one would be called a square pyramid because it has a square base. In my kit, I have an example in here of a triangular. I just had it and it slipped out of my hand. There it is. This would be an example of a triangular pyramid. It has a triangular base, but the rest of it looks just like a pyramid. Okay. The next one we will focus on is the cube. The cube is the shape that all of the sides are exactly the same length. And since I'm using the terms here, I would say all of the edges are exactly the same length, which also means that all of the faces are squares. Okay? So let's think about this cube. The first thing I want to do with the cube is figure out how many faces. Well, the faces are the square, flat sides or surfaces. Well, I'm touching one right now with my hand. It's resting on my hand. So there's one down here that I'm using as a base. And since it has one down here, there's also one on top. So there's two. So far, I know for sure this thing has, this cube has two faces. Then there are one, two, three, four faces going around the sides. The two on the top and bottom, four going around. And I'm sure my second graders can do 2 + 4 and figure out that that means there's six faces on a cube. So now let's go to the next one. How many edges would a cube have? Well, again, I'm holding it here. And the ones I can notice the most are the ones standing straight up and down. So right now I have one pointing at you. That's one. Two. There's another edge in the corner. Three. Four. But then I also have the ones going around the top. So there's four so far. One, two, three, four around the top. So 4 + 4, that's a double, that's 8. But then the base also has a square. So there's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 more. 8 + 4 more would give us a total of 12. So there are 12 edges on a cube, 12 lines where the faces meet in the corner. So we have six faces. We have 12 edges. Now let's see how many vertices are on a cube. Well, remember, the vertices are the points in the corner where the edges meet. So right here, I have an edge going this way, and I even have this one coming up. So sometimes it can be two or even three edges coming together in a vertex. So I have this one here, one. It's the point in the corner. Okay, one. Then I have this one here, two. Three. Four. Four corners on the top, and if I turn it this way, now I've got the base sticking up. One, two, three, four more. Well, we know double four is 8. Double four is 8. So on a cube, we have six faces, 12 edges, 8 vertices. I have this little sheet or this little chart that I had back at this classroom that I was going to use to help with this, and I decided to bring it here to show you. Here's the 3D shape. This is the picture, a two-dimensional picture of what a cube looks like. And you'll notice, exactly like we said, we counted six faces. We counted the edges was 12 edges. And we also said there were eight vertices. Okay, six faces, 12 edges, eight vertices on a cube. If I flip through this, I believe, yep, there's the sphere. Let's see if the chart agrees with me about everything being zero. So finally, there we go. So right now we have the picture of the sphere, the word sphere, and if we go to the number of faces on the sphere, of course, zero. There are no flat surfaces. And if I go to the number of vertices on a sphere, it is also zero. And if I go to the number of edges on a sphere, now you'll see me flip twice, and that's because this chart actually has something called a hemisphere that is not something second graders have to know. So we're sticking just with the sphere. A hemisphere is a sphere that's been cut in half. So that's why I had to flip twice. But as you can see, there's the two-dimensional model of what the three-dimensional shape of a sphere looks like. We call it a sphere. The number of faces is zero. The number of vertices is zero. The number of edges is zero. And that makes sense when I show you this shape. There are no flat surfaces, no straight lines where faces come together, and no sharp points where the edges come together. It's just a round ball. Now, one thing I want you to understand, I'm not going to go through all the rest of them, but I do want you to understand that your faces won't always have straight edges. An example, if I look at this cylinder this way, I don't see much. But when I turn it this way, there's a flat surface. Happens to be that a cylinder does have faces. The faces are circles. So faces do not have to have straight sides. They can be round. They can be a circle. Faces will always be one of the two-dimensional shapes we talked about last week. And they can be circles. All right, so just remember that. Just because you may not be able to find an edge or a vertex, you might actually be able to find faces that are circles. So just keep that in mind. Don't trick yourself on that. Faces don't have to have straight edges. All right. I hope that helps when you're working on your parts of a three-dimensional shape activity. If you need help, feel free to replay the video. That's why I do the YouTube videos. You can always rewind them and replay them so that you can look at things again. And again, don't hesitate to either message me or call me, and we can talk about this and help you understand it a little better. Okay? Now, I forgot to grab my eraser. Just one second. I need to. We're now going to talk about plant parts. Parts of a plant. The ones that they want you to know on your assignment are stem, they want you to know the leaves. They want you to know the roots. I'm trying to remember again. All right, well, let's talk about these three right now. On the stem, is the hard straight body of the plant. If we're thinking about a plant like a tree, that would be the tree trunk. If we're thinking about a plant like celery, that's the part we eat. When you eat celery, you're eating the stem of the plant. Okay, so some plants we eat different parts, but for celery, we're eating the stem. The leaves are the part that collect the sunlight, and they are they come off of the stem. They sprout off of the stem. For a plant like lettuce or cabbage, that's the part we eat. On something like celery, that's the part where sometimes when you buy it from the store, you have to cut some of the leaves off still. Carrots, it gets cut off before you eat it. Okay? The roots are the part underground. So roots are the part that are underground, and they actually collect. Oops. They collect water and minerals. So roots are the part that's under the ground that helps hold the stem up in place, and they collect the water and the minerals. So when you're doing your leaf or your plant diagram, the root is the part that you're going to have to draw underground. You're also going to have a part, and I'm running out of space, so I will grab my small whiteboard. The one part that I haven't fit on here is the seed. And the seed is the part that starts the life cycle process. You have to have a seed. This is the part that gets planted in the ground. Okay. The seed is the part that's planted in the ground, and it's the part that has to grow, or it's the part that has to sprout. To start the life cycle of a plant. I'll put this one up here. Okay, so we have the seed planted in the ground. It sprouts to start the life cycle. We have the stem, we have the leaves, and we have the roots. Those are the main parts of our plants that we will be looking at. One of the activities they want you to do in your packet is to draw a sunflower and label these parts. Okay? And I think I just remembered one other part that they mentioned to label in the packet. And those are the petals. The petals, since they're having you draw a sunflower, are the flower parts. Not all plants will have petals. It has to be a flowering plant to have petals. And when I'm saying petals, it's PET, not petals like you're riding your bike. That's with a D. Okay? So when we're talking about plants, it's petals. Has a T in it. These are the five main parts that they're going to want you to label, or that I'm asking you to label on your model of a sunflower. Just a quick tip. Remember, you can always play this back to see something if you don't remember. If I'm drawing picture of a plant, I'm actually going to draw it like I'm seeing it pushed up against glass. So I want to make sure I draw a dirt line, a soil line. And since the roots are the part underground, however you're going to draw your roots, make sure you have those underground when you go to label them. Okay. All the other parts should be above ground. So that would be my stem. I'm not going to do the whole thing. I don't want to waste your time. But if I'm drawing a flower, okay. And then I start labeling the parts by drawing lines and writing the words. Just make sure you actually draw the roots underground. You're going to want to draw a ground line. It's kind of like when you draw a map. When you draw a map, you look above. When you draw a plant, you almost want to draw it like you grew the plant inside a clear box where you can actually see the soil and see the roots in the soil. So you can label those parts. Just a tip. Seed, petals. Right. Part of your science this week will also be starting to plant your own seed. I figured I would do a demonstration of that part on Wednesday's video. So on Wednesday's video, I will actually model on the video how you can start trying to plant the seed that you get in your packet. And then I will also begin talking about we're going to make a move on in math from 3D shape parts to fractions. And so I will talk about that on Wednesday also. Again, if you have any questions or you need to look at something, remember you can always rewind the videos to look back at anything I have went over. If you don't remember what a face is, or if you don't remember what a vertex or an edge is, you can always rewind it to look back. Okay? Now, I would like to share one more chapter. Of our Secrets of Your Room, Special Edition Number 1, The Magic Escapes, by Tony Abbott. The last time we read Chapter 9. Something kind of surprising started happening at the end of Chapter 9. First of all, the picture helps me remember that young Galen and Max took off by themselves, or went off alone, to try to see if they could figure out how to stop the time machine part of the fortress that causes the entire city to go back and forward in time. I'm going to reread the last page just so that we can remember what happened at the end of Chapter 9, because if I remember right, I think something surprising is happening with Neil. "But how?" asked Julie. "The place is swarming with goblins. They're not going to let us march into Salamander's icky old throne room. Anyone have any ideas?" Neil made a strange face. I just have one thing to say. Raw, raw." The others stepped back. "Neil?" asked Kia. What I actually mean to say is, raw, raw." Neil blinked, he frowned, he twitched, he shivered. Then he began to change. His face grew long, his skin turned a sickly shade of green, and his nose, the one that was so good at sniffing pies, stretched into a snout, long and bumpy and tipped with whiskers. With one great final shudder, ploink, Neil had become a goblin. Remember, back a while ago in the older chapters, Neil decided he was hungry and ate one of Jabbo's pies. Later on, Yurik had told him, "Those are goblin pies." Well, now it looks like by eating the goblin pie, Neil had caused himself to now turn into a goblin. Chapter 10, A Riddle Among Riddles. Neil looked closely at his green clawed hands. "Uh-oh," he said. "This can't be good. It was the pie, wasn't it? It was the pie. Oh, that Jabbo. If I ever get my hands on him again, my weird green hands. Oh." His friends walked completely around him. "Ow," he squealed. "Who stepped on my tail? I mean, yikes. I have a tail? Oh, this is not good at all." Kia laughed suddenly. "No, it is good. In fact, it's perfect." "And just how do you figure that?" Neil asked, carefully running his new claws down the length of his new snout. "Because," she said, "you just found us a way into Salamandra's throne room." "Oh, no. No way. Kia, you have to change me back." And then he gasped, "Wait. You can change me back, can't you?" "Of course I can," she said. "Or Galen can. Or maybe Yurik, I think. But anyway, not just yet." "He is right," said Eric. "Looking the way you do, we'll get into the throne room easily. We can stop Spar and Salamander from joining forces. And we can take Spar back to Droom." Neil grumbled. "Sure, sure. Use the poor kid who turns into the ugly goblin. What I don't do to save the world. All right. Only don't step on my tail. It's sensitive. And actually, so is my hearing. I hear someone coming." Fwit, fwit, fwit. Before they could move, a figure flitted down the hall toward them, his face lit with a purple glow. He smiled when he saw them. "Yurik," said Eric, "you made it. You got free of the Kraken. The man held up his wand. Of course. Did you find Galen? They told him where his brother was. Good, he said. With a goblin as a cover, I don't think you'll need my help. I'll go find Max and Galen. Funny that old boatman told me to take good care of Galen. He said his own future depended on it. Strange old man. Anyway, I'd better get going. See you later. He raced away as quickly as he had come. Okay then, said Neil. Let's do this. 5 minutes later, the four friends were heading down a passage toward the throne room. The hoots and howls from the end of the hall told them that they had come to the right place. Two goblins guarded a large black door. Kia nudged Neil. We'll keep our hoods low. You tell the guards we want to go in. Neil sighed and marched up to the guards. Hey, fellow ugly goblins. I'm looking for Salamandra. You know, about this tall, yellow eyes, bunch of thorns instead of hair. The guards eyed him from head to foot.
What are the magic words?
One asked. Neil grinned, showing two rows of bumpy teeth.
My mommy taught me those, please and thank you. What and what? Said the second guard, reaching for a sword.
Julie whispered into Neil's large green ear.
How about... Oh, yeah.
Neil nodded, coughed, then said,
Would the magic words be Om Ye Pesh? Oh, at once, sir, both guards said, bowing low and thrusting the doors open instantly. Thank you, my good sirs, said Neil.
Good and ugly, said Eric under his breath. The friends entered a giant room. Wild, thorny plants grew up in every corner and hung down from the walls. Blazing, fiery cauldrons sat on platforms on each side of the room, casting golden light on hundreds of goblins standing at attention.
Salamandra, they chanted. Salamandra!
Their chanting echoed around the room and up to an enormous crystal dome at the top. Visible beyond the dome was the brightening sky of morning. Eric stiffened suddenly as they made their way along the wall. In the center of the room, under a canopy of long, curving thorns, at the top of a set of stairs, was the throne they had seen in the street. But this time, Salamandra wasn't in it. Holy cow, Eric whispered. Sitting on the throne was Lord Spar. The sorcerer glared out at the army of goblins, his hands clutching the arms of the throne.
Kia gasped. Look at him. He's already made a deal with her. An evil deal, no doubt.
A trumpet sounded. Another set of doors opened on the far side of the room, and all the goblins bowed.
Princess Salamandra, they bellowed.
The flames in the giant pots flared and leaped up when she entered, but the room itself seemed to darken and go ice cold.
Is she evil or what? Whispered Julie.
Evil, said Eric. Even the fire seems to know it.
I'm going to have nightmares about this for a long, long time to come, Neil murmured.
You have done well, my goblins, said Salamandra, slowly approaching the throne, holding her thorny staff high. My treasure rooms are full. My power continues to grow. We've robbed this time of nearly all its magic. The hour has come. It's time to move on.
Deep in her voice was a sound like the howling of dogs or wolves wailing in the night.
She's just like Spar, whispered Kia. It figures he would join together with her. They're two of a kind.
Eric eyed the sorcerer. Maybe, he thought. But there was something else in Spar's look as he gazed from the throne. It was almost as if... No, it couldn't be. Spar, can you hear me? Now, you'll see that part is bold. That means he did that silently with his mind. He can speak inside Spar's mind. Salamandra spoke again.
I have learned the riddles of the ancient rulers of earth and sea. I have stolen the great magics of every age. And yet you, Lord Spar of Droon, have told me a tale of a dark stair and of a great magic that lies hidden in another time.
Spar did not rise from the throne.
As we agreed, he said, I shall use your time portal to find it, and you shall take whatever magic remains.
Spar sat up high in Salamander's throne, and the princess herself circled slowly beneath it. But something was wrong. Eric could feel it.
Eric!
Spar's voice sounded faintly in his head. What's going on here? Eric asked. Remember, this is happening silently. Salamandra paused, then rose, step by step toward Spar. Her long cape flowed behind her, its thorns scratching the stairs like fingernails scraping on a chalkboard.
What is the coiled viper, Spar? She asked.
All in due time,
the sorcerer replied. The princess stopped.
No, she said. Now.
Flying, a thorn shot from her staff and struck the floor at Spar's feet. In an instant, thorns sprouted from the floor and whipped around him, trapping him in a cage of thorns.
What? Boomed Spar, struggling. You lied to me. You gave your word. You tricked me.
The thorns circled up to his shoulders and stopped there, enclosing him on the throne.
Whoa, said Neil. Talk about plans backfiring. She's doing our job for us. This is good.
I really don't think it's so good, said Eric. Salamandra rose to the throne.
Perhaps now you will tell me what I want to know. What is this great magic viper hidden in this world?
Spar said nothing. Nothing out loud. His words filled Eric's head.
Eric, hissed the voice of Spar. Eric, she is pushing her way into my mind, getting nearer to our secret. Her power is strong.
You cannot resist me, said the princess.
Here's a picture of Eric hearing Spar in his mind. Oh my gosh, Eric pulled his friends to him. Salamandra wants what Spar's looking for. She's sort of breaking into his mind. He's trying not to tell her that he has part of the magic with him and that I have part of it. I think he's trying to protect me, to protect us.
Spar is protecting us, said Kia. What do you mean? How do you know?
Eric breathed in deeply, then thrust his hand into his pocket. The blue gem burned his fingers, but he ignored the pain. He dragged it out of his pocket and showed the gem to his friends. Eric's hand trembled as he held the tiny stone. Spar gave this to me. It's one of the eyes of the coiled viper. For the first time since Spar had given the stone to him, Eric felt like himself again. It was as if the spell were suddenly lifted. Bright blue sparks flickered from his fingertips. Instantly, Spar's eyes sought him out.
She is too powerful for me, he whispered.
Salamandra howled suddenly.
So, yes, your mind cannot lie. I do not yet know what this viper is, but I know when it is. Prepare now to witness my power, Lord Spar of Droon. Goblins of the Time Portal, come. I know where we shall go next.
The six tall goblins the kids had seen following Salamandra in the street entered the room chanting, Om Ye Pesh, Pesh. A giant flying lizard loped in after them.
It was the same lizard the kids had once seen flying over their town. It had many wings and legs. As the chanting grew louder, the giant machine in the rooms below grew louder too. Blom, chunka chucka, blam blam, sss, and the crystal dome above them began to open. "Behold the portal of ages," said Salamandra. The golden disks hovering above the city shot beams of light from one to the other, forming a giant circle of light overhead. A sudden rushing wind swept into the room.
"Come, my goblins," Salamandra shouted. "We shall find what Lord Spar seeks. My empire will rule in every age."
A storm of air grew above the dome, like the funnel of a tornado, spinning around and around until its hugeness covered the entire city. The children could feel the floor moving and quivering. The machine was thundering and booming down below.
"Portal open," Salamandra commanded.
Everyone, even the goblin army, looked up, transfixed by the sight. It was hazy at first, then gradually became clear as the funnel of whirling air grew deeper and deeper. At first, there were the shadows of caves carved into hills, then rough stone buildings. There were giant pyramids and great statues, then sailing ships crashing over vast seas, and carriages drawn by horses on country roads. Finally, there were paved streets and tall buildings made of glass.
"It's going into our time," said Julie, trembling. "Come on, Galen, Max," Neil whispered. "Come on, Yurik, break that machine. Break it."
"I see a street," said Julie. "Cars whizzing by." Spar was staring at Eric through his cage of thorns.
"You know. You've always known."
"No. No," Eric whispered. But he already knew what he would see. He didn't know why or how, but he was sure of it. He stared into the whirling winds, and there it was. A valley surrounded by three hills, covered with fruit trees. And in the distance, he saw a house. A light brown house with a garage, a driveway, a blue door, and blue shutters. Eric staggered back. Oh! What he saw scared him to death. What he saw was his own house. Next chapter is titled Winds of Time. Chapter 11 shows a little picture of a house being thrown around by a tornado. Sure hope that's not Eric's. I'll have to leave you on that cliffhanger. Just a quick reminder, boys and girls, what we went over today. Faces, edges, vertices in math. In science, we learned about the parts of plants, their stems, their leaves, their roots, the seed, and petals. If you don't remember something, feel free to rewind the video. If you have any questions, you can always either message me or give me a call. I hope you guys have a great week. Go Cavs, and have a good day. Bye. Thank you.